Tonight, classes at St. Mary's College resume and administrators take steps to improve security following three robberies. Work starts on a health and safety policy for St. Lucia. A former ambassador to Haiti predicts disease and starvation in the hurricane-battered country. And more Castries businesses fall victim to criminals and vandals. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Wednesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story, a semblance of normalcy returned to St. Mary's College today after thieves robbed the school and left two of its security guards hospitalized earlier this week. School principal Rowan Sion says steps are being taken to improve security at the institution and to avoid a reoccurrence of this week's incident. DBS's Kendall Burton begins our news coverage.
Students and teachers returned to the school on Wednesday for the first time since the incident, many of them understandably anxious. Monday night's burglary and assault was only one in a string of burglaries of Castries schools. Before that, students were attacked and robbed on at least two occasions. One of the first orders of business that morning was a general assembly to reassure staff and students that steps were being taken to address their security concerns.
One or two of them seemed a little concerned and as to what the situation was. We were able to reassure them that everything is back to normal and they can relax in the school as they would normally. I think that went well. One of the teachers led them in a singing of a couple of songs and they participated well. So that part of it is okay.
Some of the staff who were the first to arrive on the scene remain a bit shaken. Counseling services have been made available to them in case they need it. At least one has availed herself of the service. A meeting with parents was held on Wednesday evening to bring them up to speed on what had happened and to get their input in coming up with solutions to the problem.
We haven't actually had a full parents meeting since even the first event took place when the boy was robbed the first time.
The school is waiting on the Ministry of Education to make good on its promise to provide an additional security guard for the school. In the meantime, the SMC has engaged a private security company to explore other options to augment existing security arrangements.
I know that parents and St. Lucia generally be very concerned about what has happened at St. Mary's College. I want to give the parents the assurance that we at the board level and certainly the entire management of the school doing everything and will do everything in our power to make sure that your boys are safe and that the perpetrators of this hideous crime are brought to justice.
One of the security guards injured in Monday's attack has been released from hospital, while the other remains in hospital and is reportedly undergoing several tests to ascertain the extent of his injuries.
We're very concerned about that because you can always fix the doors, always replace the things that are lost, but when human injury takes place, that really puts it in a totally different level of concern. And it is just a very brutal thing to be hitting the gunner's head of the edge of a shovel.
Students have been asked to remain vigilant and to walk in groups. Police have increased patrols of the area, which is reassuring to everyone. They all hope it can be maintained. For the DBS Newsworld, Kendall Burton reporting.
Castries businesses can't seem to catch a break. Several break-ins of city businesses have the owners on edge. On Wednesday, two more store owners showed up for work to find their show windows smashed. The owners say nothing was taken but aren't sure whether this was simply an act of vandalism or a case of burglaries interrupted. Alex Buske has more.
The owners of Abraham's textile store showed up for work as usual this morning, only to notice that the show window was broken. Nothing was stolen from the store, but the store owner says he suspects this was really a mischievous act by vandals. The Hang Ten store owner also suffered similar damage to his show window. He says he has not a clue why someone would do such a thing or why anyone would have such bad intentions. Just yesterday, two other store owners suffered similar fates. One was burglarized and the other was vandalized. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Alex Buske.
In other news, The Ministry of Labour, with help from the International Labour Organization, has started work on drafting a national occupational health and safety policy for St. Lucia. The ministry hosted a two-day workshop this week that brought together representatives from the government, private sector, and also trade unions to begin formulating the document.
The move to create a national health and safety policy for the island has been welcomed by most of the participants at this week's workshop, including the International Labour Organization representative. According to the ILO, up to 2 million people lose their lives as a result of work-related accidents and diseases every year. There are 200 million accidents reported, and 160 million people fall sick annually because of workplace hazards. With the economic losses as a result of those incidents set at 4% of world GDP, a national policy, if nothing else, just makes good economic sense.
The huge human suffering and the social and economic costs of occupational accidents and diseases ask stakeholders to mobilize to undertake more determined policies and actions to guarantee occupational safety and health. National legislation and the ILO's international standards clearly identify the responsibilities of different stakeholders and provide guidance to tackle this problem.
The concern for employers and unions is that while a huge chunk of the Labour Act, more than a third, deals with health and safety issues, not enough is being done in the area of enforcement.
The attention paid to occupational safety and health is minimum. Visits to places of work, particularly in construction sites, makes one a little apprehensive about safety procedures on the island. The Federation has embarked on an initiative to provide certified training to persons charged with ensuring health and safety at its members' facilities.
We are aware that the legislation that we have coming out of the 2012 Labour Code is probably one of the best when it comes to written word. But in terms of the enforcement and the application, there seems to be something lacking.
The expectation is that this week's workshop will produce a document that sets out a national occupational health and safety policy that will apply to all sectors of the economy. The document, once revised and fine-tuned, will be submitted to Cabinet for ratification.
After you've had this document, then that document can be used as a benchmark for all private and public sector organizations so that the application of health and safety standards would meet that requirement, and eventually we'd have a safer and healthier workplace.
While the majority of people will go through their working lives without an injury or illness directly caused by their workplace, the data is there to corroborate just how many people do. And it's not just employees that suffer. Families are affected as well.
A few years ago, we had two persons who died on construction sites. These were two men, two breadwinners. That means a number of children were without a father. And of course, that would affect their ability to be properly schooled, etc. Because if the father was a sole breadwinner, then those kids would be missing all of this.
An important complement to the efforts to develop the policy, Narcis says, is the creation of a safety culture in our workplaces. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
As Haiti struggles to recover from the devastation inflicted by Hurricane Matthew, which pummeled the island with Category 4 winds and rains, relief agencies are expressing concerns that the immediate physical damage is only a shadow of things to come. A former ambassador to the impoverished country fears that disease outbreaks and starvation could be in Haiti's immediate future.
The experts on the ground agree that Haiti faces the nightmare combination of disease and starvation in the wake of Hurricane Matthew. The torrential rains and the strong winds carried by the Category 4 storm killed hundreds and forced thousands more out of their homes. All of this at a time when the country was still reeling from the impact of successive storms, a cholera outbreak, and a massive earthquake. Former CARICOM Ambassador Earl Huntley was in Haiti in 2008 when the country was hit by 4 storms in 3 weeks. He is concerned that the conditions are ripe for a massive disease outbreak.
In October 2010, cholera appeared in Haiti, and the UN is now admitting very grudgingly that it was brought in by Nepalese soldiers, and up to now they have done really nothing to provide any compensation or restitution. And so with the flooding that has happened, and the contaminated water. That is a really very great fear.
Ambassador Huntley is concerned that thousands of Haitians now face the looming threat of starvation after the storm wiped out much of the island's farms and destroyed fishing boats.
The southwest of Haiti, that particular part, is really the food factory. It's where a lot of agriculture, a lot of trees. It is not like the typical pictures you see of Haiti, of the denuded mountains. It's very, very green. And the fear is now, with so much of agriculture being wiped out, there's going to put more pressure in a country where food supplies are not, I wouldn't say difficult, but expensive.
Of course, there are other concerns, like the potential for widespread corruption. Remember the corruption that permeated the country in the wake of the 2010 earthquake, with millions of dollars earmarked for relief efforts there, never making it to Haiti.
The biggest example is the American Red Cross, whom I hear appealing for help again. The American Red Cross received about $500 million for Haiti post the earthquake. Hardly any of that money was spent in Haiti. They said they passed on some of the monies to other organizations, but there's really nothing to show. There was one report that said all you could see was six houses that they built, and a lot of the money stayed within the organization to do other things. So one has to be concerned.
There are also political concerns. Haiti's January elections were called off 2 days before they were due to take place over concerns about escalating violence resulting from opposition claims of fraud and a subsequent refusal to participate in the exercise. Ambassador Huntley was in Haiti at the time as part of an OAS observer mission. The arrival of the storm has meant that elections have now been postponed indefinitely, leaving an interim government in place.
So there has not been the opportunity to elect a new president. His mandate, the interim president, Mr. Prevert, ended in fact in February, March. And the parliament has not extended it. So in a sense, there's a political vacuum. And I think it's another lesson for the Haitian politicians that, look, you have to get together. You have to be more united and have the interests of the country more at heart.
UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has made an emergency appeal of $120 million for food, shelter and medical supplies to help Haiti pull through the next 3 months. In the interim, he says, tensions are already mounting as people await help and as the rest of the world watches to see if they get it. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
Time now for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Busque, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
You know, the problem I have is the school children. After school, they're supposed to be at their mother's home, helping their mother. They're always roaming on the streets all 5 o'clock. That's not fair.
Oh, you didn't see them?
Huh? They just be on the block by me, but some of them buying icicles. After that, they're all in town. All 4 o'clock, 4:30. That's not the time you're supposed to be home, because so many things happening, and I'm concerned about that. The icicle lady, Merlin.
As far as I'm concerned, that thing about persons burglarizing schools, that's going too far. The government should put something in place to give proper training to our security guards, and also from where I stand, I feel they should be provided with firearms, because the guys that's burglarizing a school tend to have weapons. Why not the security guards cannot have two? I find we need to equip our security guards better, man.
Yeah. What I have trouble in myself, or what I have concern about, is that the fact that we are spiritual people, Caribbeanized spiritual people, and whatever it is, like, we do live in spirit upfully, you know. If we put some Marxist on that kind of thing, you know, see that it's real, a serious something that our spirits develop. Because we can't go through success orally to the max or to its bestness if we haven't got spiritual togetherness and capabilities and so forth and so on. So if you boost that, that would help out.
Yeah, what I want to say, recently there we had a rape case where a man had been accused from raping a lady and where we chopping up the lady. And what I am saying, as a man, that is very bad, and it hurts me to see that. And what I want the law to take into consideration, do not hide a rape victim. You could hide the person that has been raped, the female. But you cannot tell me a man has been raped and you're hiding his face. You'll have to put out this man's faces, because this man is prayers, living on women. Now the women have to see them and people have to see them when they come into the communities to protect their children. Because there are very young children out there and these men are working as a prey on the children. You cannot tell me a man rape a woman and he chopped the woman and you all hide in his face. His face is be hidden. That is time the law have to stop that. When a man rape, everybody's supposed to see his face. The same way that you commit a crime, you steal, people see your face. Raping is a crime and it's a serious crime. And we must know the perpetrators who is doing these kind of things. Do not hide their face.
100 days in office, as we stated according to the previous administration, that fight to stay alive. Five is accomplished. We did it for education, health, etc., etc. One more is the most fundamental accomplishment, which is the VAT. And I'm quoting from a very theocratical perspective, Reds. Red man. This is a serious issue we delivered after Murph. And I quote, the vibes is that five to stay alive, four is accomplished, and one is missing, which is the most important thing there now. My conclusion is we experienced four prime ministers in 100 days. I wonder if we should give them next year or whatnot. That is my conclusion.
We've just been watching The Vibe on the Street with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, Nemo encourages earthquake preparedness but discourages false social media broadcasts about non-existent disasters and charting the way forward for the nation's technical vocational training system. Welcome back to the DBS News World, and thank you so much for staying with us. The Emergency Management Organization continues to encourage preparedness for non-meteorological hazards, particularly earthquakes and tsunamis. It's also discouraging persons from either composing or spreading false reports about either of these events via social media.
There have been repeated warnings from the Trinidad-based Seismic Research Unit that the Caribbean should prepare for a severe earthquake. The experts have warned that the Caribbean islands are not only very vulnerable to earthquakes but also tsunamis. The islands have been put on notice to brace for tsunamis by the Intergovernmental Oceanic Commission of UNESCO, but there are concerns that several social media posts and broadcasts predicting earthquakes and tsunamis may be counterproductive by either causing widespread and needless panic or predisposing people to ignoring legitimate warnings and advisories. In the meantime, Nemo says it is working on an alert system that will reduce that likelihood by converting the recently installed flood early warning system into a multi-hazard warning system.
We actually have this horns, the alarms that we could trigger from here. With regards to tsunamis, the Met Office is the focal point for tsunami warning. So in the event of a warning being necessary, they would inform us, on receiving, be it the texts or emails and so on, from the Tsunami Warning Center, and we in turn would trigger these alarms. Okay, we're in the process of developing the protocols with the communities so that, they know what to do.
For now, education is a major focus for Nemo. In fact, next week, the organization, together with the University of the West Indies Seismic Research Center, will bring together members of the engineering, disaster management, tourism, and education sectors to discuss geohazards in St. Lucia. This is in an effort to help them better prepare their respective communities for earthquakes, tsunamis, and volcanic hazards. Nemo is also behind calls for tougher building codes that would create minimum standards for disaster-resilient infrastructure.
I think the Ministry of Physical Development and Planning, they are, in their own way, implementing some of the codes. Okay, of course, we do not yet have a comprehensive code that covers everything, but there are certain aspects and certain requirements, I'm certain, that are being implemented as we speak. And we could speak to our housing stock right now as compared to what it was, say, in the 1960s and 70s. We have a significantly more resilient housing stock.
Dubois says while it may not be a requirement for individuals to build according to specified standards, he is encouraging individual homeowners to take actions to reduce risk, starting by not building in areas of risk and ensuring that their homes are resilient to a broad range of hazards. As for those social media predictions of tsunamis and earthquakes, Nemo is pleading with persons to be more responsible social media users and not to share, forward, or rebroadcast information you receive unless you have composed those messages yourself and or can verify the contents and origin. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
A newly published bank report on the effects of Brexit on Caribbean economies has been welcomed by the British Caribbean Chamber of Commerce, St. Lucia. The Inter-American Development Bank's independent analysis says the effects will be negligible for 2016-2017. John Kennedy, president of BCCCSL, says the report highlights some risk and is right to do so, but that its underlying conclusions are that the direct and indirect macroeconomic impacts of Brexit are small, if not negligible. The Inter-American Development Bank report also concludes that the Caribbean's relationship with the EU on trade will continue unchanged through the Economic Partnership Agreement and associated development support. The report focused on six Caribbean countries, the Bahamas, Barbados, Jamaica, Guyana, Suriname, and Trinidad and Tobago. The report addressed recent claims that tourism is uniquely exposed to the short-term economic effects of Brexit due to the devaluation of the pound sterling against the US and EC dollar rate, whereby holidays in the Caribbean have become more expensive for the British. But the report concluded that tourism to small islands is less sensitive to changes in the country's real exchange rate, but more susceptible to the introduction and removal of direct flights, and that price elasticity is statistically insignificant for high-end Caribbean destinations. The report concluded that it was correct that the region urgently engaged with the UK in defining a post-Brexit landscape that will favor the Caribbean and to define what the region would like to get out of mutually beneficial relationships with the EU, UK, and be proactive in initiating early engagement with the EU and the UK. Several stakeholders in the education sector met recently to chart the way forward for the development of technical vocational training on the island. The idea is to come up with a flexible education and a training system and agenda that more accurately reflects market demands. More in this report.
A formulation of a roadmap for the development of TVET in St. Lucia was recently undertaken when the St. Lucia Council for TVET held a retreat and planning session at the Big Gardens Resort. The exercise provided participants with the opportunity to chart the way forward and improve on the quality of TVET training. Education Officer for TVET in the Ministry of Education, Colvis Samuels, underlined the importance of the TVET unit and TVET Council working together to meet the demands of the market.
The TVET Council can boast of being one of seven territories in the region which has been granted the authority to award the CVQ. Guyana and St. Vincent only came on recently. So for a long time, St. Lucia was among the top five or the first five territories in the region to be awarded that authorization.
Permanent Secretary in the Department of Education, Innovation and Gender Relations, Esther Braffitt, believes more must be done to bolster the image of the TVET sector in St. Lucia.
We need action within the secondary school system with regard to the CVQs. We are doing pretty well, or have done pretty well outside there, with even the start of the PLAR. What we are doing within the private sector is not too bad, but we need to publicize that. We need to let the public know our worth.
The two-day session was guided under the theme Changing Lives and Improving Quality through harmonized TVET development. From the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, I am Fina Neptune reporting.
Time now for Core Values with Hannah Jang.
Thank you. One of the main projects that Peace Corps volunteers take on within their schools is library development. An important part of making sure that school libraries run smoothly is having student library leaders. Letitia Thompson is a Peace Corps volunteer at Richfong Combined School, who recently organized a training session for 10 students from grades 4 and 5 to become library assistants. She hopes that this initiative will encourage sustainability of the library at her school.
Most importantly, as a Peace Corps volunteer here on the literacy project, it was very important to expand the use of the library. And of course, we want to make the library a sustainable resource, not only for the students, but also for the teachers that are here. So with the library assistants, hopefully that would be fundamental to the continuity of the library at Richfong Combined School, as well as it being a resource for the community itself.
Ms. Thompson invited Nicole Gaston, a Peace Corps response volunteer who works with the public libraries around St. Lucia, to facilitate the training session with the 10 students. During the session, students reviewed the rules of the library, the order and placement of books, as well as the process for checking out books. Having knowledge of these procedures, Ms. Gaston says, makes the library more accessible to them.
It's really more about just getting them to feel kind of engaged and like they're part of the library. And I think also to give them a little bit of ownership of the library as well. And so that it's not like, it just to demystify the process a bit, because often when you come to a library, it seems kind of like not a very welcoming space. I feel like that's feedback that I get a lot. And so doing something where I can have children come in and feel like they are part of the library, they're involved in it, just give them that sense of ownership and what it is to, you know, understand the processes and understand why things are done the way they are.
The group of students consisted of 2 boys and 8 girls, all of whom expressed interest in assisting with the library. After the training session at their school, they visited the Denry Public Library for a tour. The group came away with many new lessons learned.
My favorite part of library training, I enjoyed when we were making the ideas and when we talked about each other.
It's important to be a librarian assistant because without a librarian or librarian assistant, when people come to read books, they would have chaos in the library.
With this team of little librarians on board, not only can more reading happen at the school, but perhaps qualities like responsibility, leadership, and accountability can be cultivated as well. For Core Values, I'm Hannah Jang.
When the DBS News World continues in just a moment, Rise St. Lucia Inc. promotes the growth and consumption of organic foods. You're watching the DBS News World. Rise St. Lucia Inc. says the first phase of its Good Food Revolution was a huge success. The initiative is undertaken in collaboration with Global Environment Fund and the St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association. It offers a series of training opportunities designed to encourage organic farming production and consumption in St. Lucia.
Rise's role in this initiative is to train farmers in business and development, marketing, and to work with the Ministry of Agriculture to produce a policy that would create an environment where organic food production is the order of the day in St. Lucia.
As we're approaching this from a not only from a business point of view, but from a health point of view, we believe that organic food is the healthy food. And we think that St. Lucia should be an organic producer. We should be a green nation, and we should be marketing ourselves as such, not only for our own locals, but even for our visitors as well.
Dr. King says this initiative is greatly significant because in the face of mounting chronic non-communicable diseases, the organization believes that food and nutrition are key components in maintaining good health.
We believe that organic food, we believe also that even the judicious approach to genetically modified organisms. We think that we have to be exceedingly careful and our policies must be very clear to protect our people and make sure that since food is so important to our health, we think clearly we must address healthy food so we can have healthy people. And we believe that organic food is healthy food.
With the first phase of the project completed, which was training the farmers, Dr. King says the business component of that initiative is on the verge of being completed.
Then we want to move into a public public campaign for education, and also at that same time be looking at policy development together with our partners in the Ministry of Agriculture, and take it from there so that we get to our final goal, which is, as I said, that legal and policy environment that creates the organic food production and consumption that we think is so important.
The launch of the new phase of the organic food revolution took place at the St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association training room on Wednesday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
In other news, the St. Lucia Civil Service Credit Union on Wednesday awarded 9 scholarships and bursaries to students who excelled at the CXC exams and are now furthering their education at the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. Alex Bousquet reports.
The St. Lucia Civil Service Credit Union awarded 3 scholarships and 6 bursaries.
What we emphasize this morning is the importance of education and the role that we play. We always say that credit union is people helping people. It's a member organization, and some of our principles stands for that. Principle 5 talks about educating the members. And one of the key things we do is to make sure every year we budget. So the civil service for the last 5 years have been budgeting over $100,000 a year for members' education and for scholarships.
Bursaries, Mr. Francis says, will facilitate the 7th principle, which is community-based.
What it means that we're helping the young people to become better citizens. So the bursaries now is academic and also need. So whereas the scholarship is strictly academics, the bursaries we look at good performance as well as people who need assistance. So we are assisting both sectors of our community.
Today, on behalf of everybody that has received scholarship and bursaries from the St. Lucia Civil Service Cooperative Credit Union, we were rewarded for our efforts and the sacrifices that we made over the 5 years at secondary school. I was very blessed to be a scholarship recipient at the Common Entrance. And I just want to say thank you to the credit union for believing in me and just continuing to support me, and it helps a lot because I know education is expensive.
Over the 5 years, she has worked hard, as she said. She got a first scholarship from the St. Lucia Credit Union, and that has helped quite a bit. And now she has worked hard to qualify again. She didn't get it by just getting it, she got it because of by merit. And she got 10 ones in her subjects, and then she's moving on to Sir Arthur Lewis. And we are very thankful for the Civil Service Association for granting us that scholarship.
Beyond that, Mr. Francis says, it's a way of showing young people the role that they can play in the credit union movement, as he says that the survival of the credit union depends on the youth. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
The Ministry of Education has teamed up with the St. Lucia Football Association to design a program to help girls interested in soccer to play the sport. More in this report.
Education District 2 is helping in efforts to promote the growth of female football on the island. District 2 recently hosted a female football festival at the Saab Plainfield in Fiji in collaboration with the St. Lucia Football Association. The football festival provided girls aged 6 to 12 years with an exciting, interactive introductory football experience. Public Relations Officer of District 2's Sports Committee, Christopher Duncan, believes this initiative will empower and raise awareness among girls about the game of football.
The St. Lucia Football Association, via its parent body FIFA, has been given the mandate to expose every child in St. Lucia to a football experience, and hence, along with the District 2 Sports Committee, which tries to enrich and give each child as much of a holistic sporting development as possible, we came together, and this activity will serve both of those purposes.
Technical Director of the St. Lucia Football Association, Seth Spod, appealed for the revitalization of female football in St. Lucia.
We'd like to encourage more girls to participate, and the reason is we feel as though the female football worldwide now is becoming more and more popular, and we'd like to go as far as we can. We'd like to push our St. Lucia Association as hard as possible to try and get our women's football up there.
A group of coaches trained by FIFA provided instruction on football techniques to the young girls who participated in the festival. From the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, I am Fennel Neptune reporting.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt. Finally from us on the lighter side. A South Florida man warned for the safety of his BMW amid Hurricane Matthew decided to protect the vehicle by driving it into his house. Randy Jalil of Port St. Lucie said he had only enough room in his garage for two of his collectible BMWs during the weekend storm, so he set about finding a more creative solution for his BMW E30 M3. Jalil posted a series of photos to Instagram showing the car parked behind a couch inside his home. He posted a video showing how he carefully backed the car out of the house through the double doors after the storm had passed. He says he's owned the vehicle for about 8 years now, and that the last few years there was a spike in value with these cars. He says the car is his absolute pride and joy, and he plans to own it for years to come. While most people with similar models will keep them tucked away in the garage to keep the value up, Jalil believes cars are meant to be driven, and so he drives his every day. Time now for the usual reminder. Classes at St. Mary's College resume, and administrators take steps to improve security following three robberies. Work starts on a health and safety policy for St. Lucia. A former ambassador to Haiti predicts disease and starvation in the hurricane-battered country. And more Castries businesses fall victim to criminals and vandals. And that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening and inviting you to stay with us, because at 8:30 tonight, you could join me for Newsmaker Live. See you then.